come near to God. Exodus 24, 1 to 8, as we continue our study on this series of messages, beginning of the Hebrew nation. We have three thoughts. The words of the covenant, verse 1 to 4a, the altar of sacrifice, verse 4b to 6, the blood of the covenant, verse 7 to 8. The Apostle Paul said to the church in Rome, in Romans chapter 12, and verses 1 to 2, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service, and be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good, acceptable, and perfect will of God. He was soliciting a commitment from the Christians in Rome. After he delineated the tenets of the Christian faith in the first 11 chapters, he tells them, this is what God has done for you to make you his child in the renewed relationship after your fall. Nothing short of a total devotion of thanksgiving and consecration is required of you after all that God has done for you. What has God done for us? He said in Hebrews 5:8 or Romans 5:8, but God commendeth his love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Peace with God. An entity that is within our heart, that God gives to us, whereby we are at rest in the soul, by whom also we have access by faith into this grace wherein we stand and rejoice in the hope of glory. What God is doing for us, the change that came from within us when our sins are forgiven, repented of, we know that the blood of Jesus Christ has washed us from all our sins, much more than being now justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him. What is this wrath? Well, the judgment of God in hellfire. This is what God has done for us through Christ Jesus. For if we were enemies, Romans 5:10 says, we were reconciled to God by the death of his son. Much more, being reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. And not only so, we also joy in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom we now received the atonement. That as sin hath reigned unto death, even so might grace reign through righteousness unto eternal life by Jesus Christ our Lord. What a great salvation that God has brought within us, a miracle of miracles in our lives. In Romans 8 verse 1, he says, there is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the Spirit, but after the flesh. The Spirit of God has made us alive to live this life in the beauty of holiness. We will not go back like a dog to its vomit. We know the filthiness of sin. We know the consequences of sin, which is death, and therefore, we flee, we move far away from that which causes us to fall, to be weak. So the Apostle Paul said to the Christians, that the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. So the Apostle Paul sought a commitment from the Christians in Rome to walk in the Spirit, to do the will of God, to receive his blessings. And in fact, indeed, it is a sanctified choice to walk with God, a choice that we make, and it will be a daily, moment-by-moment commitment to walk with God. We recall the hymn, O Jesus, I have promised. It says, O Jesus, I have promised to serve thee to the end. Be thou forever near me, my master and my friend. I shall not fear the battle, if thou art by my side. Nor wander from the pathway, if thou wilt be my guide. Oh, let me feel thee near me. The world is ever near. I see the sights that dazzle me. The tempting sounds I hear. My foes are ever near me, around me and within. But Jesus, draw thou nearer and shield my soul from sin. A hymn of consecration that God has, what God has done for us and causes us to want to live this life in return, to serve Him, to love Him with all that we have. Oh Jesus, thou hast promised to all who follow thee that where thou art in glory, there shall thy servant be. And Jesus, I have promised to serve thee to the end. Oh, give me grace to follow my master and my friend. Why did God solicit a commitment from his people? Because he gave them a choice to love him and serve him. Moses sought a commitment from the children of Israel while they are encamped at the foot of Mount Sinai, 3 months after they came out of Egypt. After God gave them the law, the laws and the judgments, Exodus chapter 19, all 20, 21, 22, and 23. And they had this opportunity out of Egypt, no longer slaves, for a new start, a fresh start, a clean slate, a full slate with God. Egypt and its idolatry was behind them, shut out by the Lord, by the thundering waves of the Red Sea, falling upon the pursuing Egyptian chariots. There was a clean, clear break from their bondage as slaves in Egypt. Indeed, in Christ, we are made every whit clean, and the blood of Jesus Christ washes us from all sin. And as God's free men, we are called to live as free men, to behold and enjoy the beauty of holiness, the life of peace and joy and abundance in the presence of God, and to invoke that commitment for a new life in Christ, a new life as a nation of witnesses to the nations of the world. Israel was called to a commitment to walk with God according to his laws, Exodus 20, and his judgments, Exodus 21 to 23, to come near to God. When Israel obeyed the laws and judgments of God, the wisdom of God, the nation shall prosper and yet prosper. Remember last Lord's Day, we were speaking about this. Solomon said in Proverbs 4:4-9, he taught me also and said unto me, let thy heart retain my words, keep my commandments and live. Live, the word there is preserved. Do the will of God and let him take care of you by his good laws. Get wisdom, get understanding, forget it not, neither decline from the words of my mouth. Forsake not, and she shall preserve thee. Love her, and she shall keep thee. Wisdom is a principal thing. Therefore, get wisdom with all thy getting, get understanding. Exhort her, and she shall promote thee. She shall bring thee to honor when thou dost embrace her. She shall give to thy head an ornament of grace, a crown of glory shall she deliver thee. 3 thoughts. The words of the covenant, the altar of sacrifice, the blood, the covenant of blood, the words of the covenant. Verse 1 of Exodus 24. And he said unto Moses, come up unto the Lord, thou and Aaron, Nadab and Abihu, and 70 of the elders of Israel, and worship ye afar off. And Moses alone shall come near the Lord, but they shall not come nigh, neither shall the people go up with him. And Moses came and told the people all the words of the Lord, and all the judgments, and all the people answered with one voice, and said, all the words which the Lord hath said, we will do. And Moses wrote all the words of the Lord. For Israel to thrive as a nation, God's laws and judgment is the gel that will seal their prosperity and peace. And the Lord, through Moses, sought a commitment from them for their good. It was a vow of consecration made before God that will put them to a good start. The Lord indeed knows the weakness of the human spirit and the human heart. The Lord sought from them a commitment, a, con- a consecration so that they would begin well, begin with the Lord. The concerted effort of Israel was needed for a national witness, and the people are encouraged to do the will of God together, and God will prosper them. But you notice here, the sons of Aaron, Nadab and Abihu, were called also before the Lord. And look what happened after that consecration vow. They deviated. Leviticus chapter 10, verse 1 and 2 tells us, and Nadab and Abihu, sons of Aaron, took neither of them the censer and put fire therein, and put incense thereon, and offered strange fire before the Lord, which he commanded them not. And there went out fire from the Lord, and devoured them, and they died before the Lord. What a judgment that came when they did not obey the known instructions of God, and they were struck immediately. It is one thing to begin well; it is another to end well. Our text tells us that they went out of their way to offer that which the Lord did not command them. How frightening it is that God sent fire to consume them. The first thought, the words of the covenant, the people committed themselves. All the words which the Lord had said, we will do. And Moses wrote all the words of the Lord. The words of the covenant, the altar of sacrifice. In order to seal that vow which they said before the Lord commanded Moses to make an altar, build an altar under the hill, Mount Sinai, and 12 pillars, verse 4 tells us, early in the morning, Moses was asked to do this, build an altar under the hill, and 12 pillars according to the 12 tribes of Israel. Every tribe will be represented here. It will be a commitment that is solicited for every tribe of Israel. So everyone in Israel is represented. He sent the young men and the children of Israel, which offered burnt offerings and sacrifice of peace offerings and oxen unto the Lord. So a memorial was built to commemorate the event of their consecration. And you recall, it was a new beginning when they left Egypt, and God wanted to start them off in the best footing for a nation to be formed. They needed a people. When they came out of Egypt, they were a people. And at the foot of Mount Sinai, or in Sinai itself, after 3 months, God gave them the law. And now God solicited a commitment for them before they would possess the land and become a full-fledged nation. A consecration to action, a memorial is to be built to commemorate the event of their consecration. And Moses instructed that offerings of thanksgiving and dedication be made unto the Lord at the altar that the Lord instructed Moses to make ready. He will have all the tribes represented. Each tribe will have their individual role for the prosperity of the nation as a witness for God. Indeed, parents are consecrated at the baptism of their infant to bring up their children in the fear and admonition of the Lord. Remember, we mentioned this last Lord's Day, Proverbs 22:6. Train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. In the way he should go, initiate the child according to the mouth of his way, at the opening of his mouth, of his path, is the literal translation. When he begins life, the journey of life, he's equipped with a series of instructions how he should conduct himself in every step he takes. This is what God is doing for Israel, giving them the laws, the judgments, the instructions. The parent is to show the child his duties, the dangers, the blessings of the path, giving him directions how to perform his duties, how to escape dangers, how to secure blessings, all that is like before him as he begin life. And he is to, well, inculcate this daily, a slow process into a habit and the way that he should go and what he should do. Parents are to prepare them, and the child will be taught the way of God. The gospel will be shared to the child at an early age. church so that you can be saved. Without spiritual life, the child is what the Bible calls the natural man. And the Lord instructs parents to give them the gospel from an early age that they might be saved. And what is to be taught to the child from a young age? The scriptures, so that they may know the things of God, they may know God, so that when they grow up, he will be properly disciplined. When he is young, he will be self-controlled and responsible. And when he is old, he will not turn aside from the faith. The Old Testament term, to apostatize, to rebel against God. And so it's an encouragement to parents here, a vow of consecration. We do this at the beginning, making a commitment with God. This is what Israel is doing, so that we may remember. A memorial was made so that Israel could remember what they have vowed before God. The third thought, we said, the words of the covenant, altar of sacrifice, and thirdly, the blood of the covenant. And he took the book of the covenant and read in the audience of the people, and they said, all that the Lord had done will we do, and be obedient. And Moses took the blood and sprinkled it on the people and said, behold, the blood of the covenant which the Lord had made with you concerning all these words. The vow was sealed by the killing of an animal, and the blood shed in order to seal that promise that was made for them, by them. A solemn covenant was made between God and Israel. Indeed, a covenant that God wanted Israel to remember. Remember how God would want them to prosper, and that he is instructing them to do what is needful so that they would begin this new life as a nation consecrated to the Lord, to obey his laws, and they will surely prosper and yet prosper. Indeed, we draw near to God by the blood of Christ shed for the remission of our sins. And there was one time in our life when we come before God, repenting of our sins, receiving the good news of what Jesus Christ had done for us, died for our sins, and 3 days later rose again from the dead, victorious. And we took hold of this, and we thank God there was that first love, that fervent love for the Lord in our hearts as we begin our Christian life. God wanted Israel to remember that moment that he gave them the law. They began a new life with him as a nation. And so that as the years go by, they would continue on that same good footing that the Lord has initiated them. And that they will go on from prosperity to prosperity, from peace to peace, from faith to faith. What a great God we have. The Lord wanted them to consecrate themselves to him, and then to continue to live for him daily. May we too remember how in time past we have made vows before the Lord, we have consecrated ourselves to want to serve God. Have we forgotten what we have said to the Lord in our past? Well, time may have passed, and our love may have grown cold at one time or another. Well, because of the trials that came our way, the temptations that befell us. But the Lord says that you remember what you have promised to the Lord. Oh Jesus, I have promised to serve thee to the end. May the Lord help us indeed to serve him with renewed zeal and purpose as we recall and remember how God solicited a commitment from Israel at the start of their journey to nationhood. Amen. Let us pray. Father, we thank thee for this message of commitment, consecration that the Lord showed to us. for Israel at the foot of Mount Sinai to draw nigh to God and to obey his laws so that they may prosper and yet prosper in their life. Lord, help us too to do thy will, follow thy commandments, fear thee, love thee, consecrate our lives to serve thee with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength. Lord, may thou bless thy people as they love and serve thee with all their heart. This I pray with thanksgiving in Jesus' name. Amen.